for the flash so that if you have questions later, you can check the tape. Can you see the slides on your screen? Okay. So, last time we talked about time frames or time series that are changing over time, like GDP in Pakistan. GDP here, in fact, is even less stationary than in other countries. That is both volatile and also changing in terms of the variance and the mean. So when a time series is changing so drastically over time, it's difficult for us to use it for forecasts. So we just throw away the transformed time series into something that is easier to predict. And it turns out that the first difference of a time series is usually much easier to work with than the level of the time series. That's true for GDP about everywhere except Pakistan. Here, you have to take about the third difference, not the first, not the second, but the third difference to get stationarity, a very difficult to forecast. And that is a useful approach if we are just interested in forecasting. But in economics, we may also just to know how well the time series can help us to test macro and macroeconomic theories. Most theories can focus on describing the equilibrium. But what is an equilibrium for a non-stationary series over time? That's the problem. To answer that question about how to project, for example, the equilibrium for consumption in the UK over the long run, it turns out that it is not absolutely necessary for us to find a stationary series. All that we need is that a time series that is easy to predict, but instead a relationship among variables that consumption and income, a relationship that is easy to predict. It turns out that it is easier to work with the relationship than with each individual time series. This is the point behind cointegration. So, for example, the Keynesians tell us that consumption is a linear relationship of income. We already know that both consumption and income are non-stationary variables, but it turns out that the relationship between consumption and income is stationary in a sense. So let's brush up a bit on stationarity since we've had a spring break in interim. And as a practical matter, let's see how we can use stationarity to forecast and then suddenly move on to cointegration. I have a case study for you about cointegration in the Sudan. Here's you remember that we destroyed abandoned block at a time series that is expected to increase as the decrease in the next time period. So in other words, of income and purchase time to settle difference only on income last year and on abandoned shock. The shock is the difference between income today and income last year. In this case, we can think of income at time t and income at time t minus 1 as two separate time series. Both of them are non-stationary and part because of the dividend is increasing in Pakistan to GDP for some periods. So even though the two time series are each non-stationary, difficult to predict, the first difference is itself in fact stationary, that is GDP this year minus GDP last year. The difference is a trend that is easier to predict than the original level of GDP. And here's why. We assume that E is abandoned variable, usually that it follows a normal distribution. Detroit is random. It has an expected value of zero for every time period. So the mean of E does not change over time. The mean expected value is always zero. And in addition, if it is normally distributed, E also has a constant variance over time. People call that variance of sigma. So here's what I mean. There is our error term. You can think of it as an external shock. So, for example, if Iran begins producing oil again, oil prices will fall around the world, and therefore oil revenues will fall in Pakistan. The Iranian oil production is an external shock to GDP in Pakistan. We assume, although not necessary, that the error term is normal. So remember that the stationarity of these prior that the basic characteristics of the time series T do not change over time. So we have a constant expected value, a constant variance, and then the condition on covariance that it's not necessarily constant, but doesn't depend on the term treated directly. Okay, so what do we mean by mean or expected value in this case? The mean is equal to the sum of all values of dt over time divided by the number of time periods of a call that n. No problem there. And what about the variance? What do we mean by this in simple terms? So the variance is a measure of volatility or dispersion over time. But how much does GDP change in terms of time from 1 year to the next? So this is the sum of a variation that is formulated rather precisely. It is the difference between GDP at time t minus the mean or average value of GDP over time. People add up all those deviations. And in each case, people spare it and then divide by either n or n minus 1, depending on whether you have a sample variance or a population of variance. If n is very large, it doesn't make the difference whether you look at the sample or population variance. But the reason for subtracting one for the sample is that we use up a degree of freedom in order to set the mean, which is prior to the calculation of variance. And then finally, what is the covariance? What do we mean by that? So covariance is the expected value of a couple of deviations for y and x, for example, for income and consumption, to every time period t. So it involves the deviation in income at time t of away from the performed by me. So there's one deviation, and then we will multiply that by the deviation for x. So, for example, let y equal consumption. and bit x equal n time. So here's a question for x to credit. Would you expect the covariance to be positive or negative in the case for consumption and income? Well, Mr. Gibson has just told us that when income rises in the UK, people spend more money. So when we have a large deviation for income, that is when ST minus the mean of X is positive, we also expect to see a rise in consumption above average. These two deviations are both positive at the same time. So if spending is high, it's probably because income is high as well. On the other hand, if income is low, and this is low, below this average, what would you expect to be the case for spending? Spending is low too. So the product of the deviations is a negative number with a positive negative number when income is low. This deviation is also low, negative. And consumption will also be a negative deviation as well. And therefore, the product is positive. So we conclude that the covariance of income and consumption involves a series of positive numbers. And therefore, covariance is positive to consumption and income. Okay, good. And another puzzle. Suppose that why this time is the unemployment rate and X again is in town. Now, is the covariance positive or negative? Well, let's see. Suppose that we had a recession in Pakistan but last year. The income is unusually low. So the deviation of income in Pakistan in the year 2020 is below the long-run average of GDP. The last year, unemployment was unusually high, so that deviation is positive. Low income, high unemployment. that the product of Y this 2 minus its mean times unemployment that 2 times its mean is negative. A negative number multiplied by a positive number. So the covariance of unemployment and income involves a series of numbers that are all negative. Thus, the convergence of unemployment and income is negative. So, anyway, you have earned a couple of extra credit points for thinking about variance and covariance. Okay, so back to our error term, which is normally distributed. If the expected value is as likely to rise as to fall, so the expectation is evil. If chances are just as good that ET will rise by unit as to fall by unit, then chances are 50-50 that it will be positive or negative. Let's say for a fun toss. Half a chance that it provides a strength to a value of 1, and also half a chance that it will fall, in that case, a strength to it a value of minus 1. So the expected value is feeble, even though it is impossible for the actual X plus value to be zero. The X plus value is either 1 or minus 1. But we're not concerned with that. We are concerned with the expectation, the X ante value of the B. Zero is constant over time, and therefore the error term satisfies that condition to stationarity. And then for a normal variable, we assume that the variance of probability sigma is also constant over time. So in checking the stationarity of the error term, all that we need to consider now is the covariance. In this case, you know, looking at just one time changes, not two. They're looking only at the time changes, e.g. So the covariance is for the value of the term today, and the value of the term of yesterday. And we assume that the covariance is constant with respect to time t. So in other words, of the covariance, for example, for the stop today, which is 2021, the covariance of the relationship of the shock this year with the shock of last year is equal to the covariance of the shock in 2020 with respect to the shock in 2019. The covariance is the same any time that we are looking at one period difference in the two shocks. It doesn't depend on when we are looking at that one period difference. It doesn't depend on whether the present term is 2021 or 2020. But note that this does not mean that every covariance is always the same. This covariance may differ, for example, from the one that involves two shocks that are distinguished by 2 years rather than one. For example, this shock may be in the term of 2021 relative to the shock 2 years before of 2019. That shock may differ from the one period of distinction. But however, although seasonality will permit that time of distance, it will require that a covariance of two shocks that are 2 years apart is always the same. For example, shocks in 2020 and 2018. Presumably, the two-period covariance is smaller than the covariance for a one-period time because GDP, for example, when is a truth in 15 years is likely to be very, very uniform. GDP this year in Kazakhstan is likely to be a lot of GDP next year. Maybe the correlation is as high as 9.95. But if you're looking at GDP this year and GDP 20 years ago, there is not much of a correlation because today's economy is so different from that of 20 years ago. So even though a covariance may diminish as the time difference increases, the series ET, they're still stationary. That's one that's a covariant in the sense it's stationary over time. Okay, so this is the background behind the stationarity of abnormally distributed error term. We assume that the error term satisfies the covariance condition because we assume that every error is independent of other errors. And so the covariance of the error term over time is zero in this case. And they both satisfy our condition that the covariance does not depend on time t. The covariance, for example, of the term ET at time t and also at time t minus 1 is zero regardless of the value of t, because every error term is independent of all other terms. So, for example, we observed this year that the coronavirus has decreased GDP in Pakistan. The coronavirus is a negative shock to GDP this year, but we will assume that next year the impact of the coronavirus doesn't depend on what happened this year or any other shock. For example, maybe next year, Iran could begin producing more oil, another negative shock to GDP in Pakistan. But that shock of Iranian oil production is utterly different from the shock that is due to the coronavirus. There is not a relationship between the coronavirus and the oil produced by Iran. The two shocks are independent. So the intuition is, if you look at the covariance over here, that it is just as likely that y will rise and s will fall as this, that y will rise at the same time as x. The problem is as likely to be positive as to be negative. So overall, that the sum of the products turns to zero. So here's an example. Let's say that S and Y are independent, that they occur independently of one another. And so, maybe this year, we have a positive shock in X. 3 units of the diesel, and then we have a negative shock to Y. They equal minus 2, 4 by T. However, it times the T minus 1. We have another positive shock to X, but this time, this sort of randomness, but at time T minus 1 also rises. So that shock is 2 just like X. Okay, so the covariance in this case, the F and Y, is the sum of the products minus 4 to time t plus 4 to time t minus 1. And then we had 2 time observations, so this is divided by 2. The covariance in this case is 0. 0 for indeterminate variables. But the interpretable with the reason for why covariance is 0 for independent variables. Because if so, then you have a good understanding of why a normally distributed variable is stationary. I had 6 minutes after 8 o'clock. If you want to take a break of 15 minutes and then reconvene at 8:21, give you a chance to get your high tea or the coffee. Okay, good. So I will stop recording now and we will take a break. Thank you. Welcome back to the second half of Friday Night Thesis 2. For now, we will continue our discussion of stationarity and cointegration. And if we have time, look at a practical example using Excel. By the way, may I ask, are you both comfortable with the Excel spreadsheet? Do you have access to Excel? Okay, good.
Yes.
Good. So we can use Excel to run forecasts. First thing so far. Okay. So we have seen that if we had a non-stationary time series, we can substitute for the first difference of the time series of to restore stationarity. The stationary time series is easier to analyze than the original non-stationary level variable. So, as you recall, that the problem that we are trying to avoid is that two variables that are dependent on time, they both depend on a third time trend of, for example, innovation over time. So the fact that we observe a linear relationship between GDP and foreign direct investment does not necessarily mean that there is a direct relationship between FDI and gross domestic product. It may be the case that both of these time series are relating to a third variable, and so the fact that these seem to be positive in this depression may deceive us into thinking that GDP depends on foreign direct investment. The solution to the problem is to eliminate the impact of other time trends and then look at the relationship between GDP and FDI. When we take a first difference of a time series, we are eliminating the linear time trend. That's why using first differences is useful. And there is the summary of our discussion. So let's now turn to forecasting. Suppose that we had 10 series for GDP and foreign direct investment in Kazakhstan. We already know that the first differences of those two variables is stationary by hypothesis. So we have eliminated time trends that we are not interested in, and so we address this first difference of GDP on the first difference of foreign direct investment. We think that investment by foreigners in Kazakhstan will stimulate our economy. But we would like to forecast GDP next year. How can we do that? Well, first we run the regression of these differences. Now let's expand the equation by substituting the explicit terms for both first differences. And this is the FDI. And then we solve the GDP at time t. It is a function of known values for GDP and FDI, and also a function of the other term. Now, because we have run the regression, we already have information about the coefficients C and F. The forecast GDP for next year, 2022, just update the equation. So just add 1 year to all of the time observations. To T, we substitute T plus one, and so forth. And there is our forecast model for GDP. and next year to teach us what. So there's we have a slight problem. We know what values are today, the plan T, but not for the year T+1. However, our forecast model depends on FDI next year, for which we don't have much information. So we are going to have to estimate FDI and also the other term for next year, you. But we have already seen that the value that we expect today for the other term next year is zero. So this term drops out of the forecast. And there is our equation. We can plug in various values for FDI of the forecast the impact on GDP. Now suppose that you're nervous about trying to anticipate what FDI will be next year. You would have to remove the uncertainty from the forecast of GDP. In that case, we address GDP not on the current value of FDI, but instead on the lag of FDI in the specifics. So there is a new forecast model. The first difference of GDP is a function of the first difference of FDI last year. Again, for the forecast, expand the expression. And so for GDP at time T, which is a function of its own lag and also of two lags of FDI. Ability and return, so that a thickness depends T+1. Now, the forecast depends only on values that we already know, the value of GDP this year and FDI this year, as well as FDI of last year, we know all those values, and we will again set the error term equal to zero in this case. So in some ways, this forecast is easier to work with than the original one in which GDP depended concurrently on foreign direct investment. So here is an extra credit problem for you if you like speculating on the tangy. You will find at the National Bank website a daily exchange rate for the tangy with respect to other currencies like the dollar. So, as an offer, 50 points of extra credit, if you will download that data, assume that the first difference is stationary and the first has the value of the exchange rate of T. for the next day. So here's an example of vision itself. I had data for the percent change in GDP for the United States. Here are the annual figures. So I'm going to use term GDP in this case for about $15. Put it over here. Did this time. And here is the change of GDP. I will call it Y at time T. Okay, so now I'd like to reduce this on the lag of YT. So for example, in 1930, YT is minus 11.9. At time in 1931, it is minus 16. So the lag in 1931 is the value of Y at time 1930. So I will pick up these values here, copy them, and then create the lag over here for the T minus one. So notice that we are losing an observation because we do not have information about the T in 1929. Okay. Now, if you work with Excel, you probably know that Excel can do regressions. Under the phone, we have tab data. Look for data analysis. If you don't already have it, go over the options and then add the data analysis tool pack. Well, let's see. Here's the regression. We are asked to input the dependent variable and the independent variable. And to include the labels and the confidence level. Usually, you should not set the confidence level because we want to let the regression take the best value for the target, not force it. So, we are putting the four tests, the T, using the lag. The dependent variable, in this case, is by T. We had values, including the label, from page 7 down to page 23. So first, let me picked up the first observation. Since we have a missing value for that observation. Okay, good. You can look this up. So the dependent variable dx values in P7 including the label. Down to P22. And then the independent variable is the lag from L7 down to L22. And I will put this on a new page for test. And there is our data. How would you interpret our findings? Well, remember that the T represents the percent change the growth rate of GDP in the United States from the past year. So our results say that if the economy was growing last year, it is likely to be growing as well this year. If there is an increase of 1% of economic growth last year, this year, GDP should rise to 2/3 of 1% as a consequence. Check out the two statistics. Ostensibly, we had a significant relationship in the lag. And then it's interesting to take a look at the detectables. And the standard detectable is a detectable divided by the standard deviation of the equation. So the detectable is a mistake in the model. Is it for y? The time t minus our prediction of my t, that was the lag that we used. Or minus the intercept 2.98 minus 0.67. Times the lag. That's our error. The standard deductible is useful because it identifies the specific branch errors. This is a deductible divided by a measure of the typical deviation, the standard deviation of the equation. So a rule of thumb, an outlier This is a bunch of small mistakes. This is been predictable that it seems about too. In this case, do you see any outliers for a data set? It appears as if all the standard variables are fairly small. None of them are greater than 2 as an absolute value. So we can use the entire data set without worrying about distortions that are due to including outliers. Had we had an observation with a standard distributable of greater than 2, we would have considered deleting them from the data set. Okay, good. So there is a protest model, there is the intercept. Evidently, there is a percentage change of about 50% in GDP annually that does not depend on what happened last year. Minus 0.67 times the lag. So let's say that we wrote the forecast. Y and time P plus 1. Using the lag model. So we update the time to by T. Why? So time T mentioned 31 is minus 16, and then the lag to 1930 was minus 11.9. So our forecast to year 1931 to 1932 is 2.17, the intercept of death has not changed. And correcting my coefficients. Okay, so the forecast is 2.97 plus 0.67 times the economic growth that occurred in 1931. So this is minus 11.6, I think. Zero. And there is the forecast. A drop in GDP in 1932 of 4.4%. In this case, we have gravely overestimated economic growth in 1932. But in this case, it's because of events that have not yet been reflected in our data set. The Great Depression in the United States. So there is the idea behind forecasting. In terms of stationarity, can you think of any other reason why the forecast for 1932 turned out to be so far off the mark? Well, it is really likely that a transition is non-stationary. We can check that. By looking at the graph. There's YT over time. And you can see that this series is highly non-stationary, at least from a first glance. There is not a constant mean that is evident over all these observations. We can check formally for non-stationarity with the 50-fold test, but right now, we can observe that maybe the reason why our forecast is so far off was that, in fact, we do not have a stationarity series. So the model that we estimated is not in fact describing the time series all the time. The actual time series is changing in ways that the prison does not represent. So there is the whole nine yards on forecasting in itself, if you don't have another software package that's better on e-views. So you can apply the Excel regression to your observation and forecast of the exchange state in Kazakhstan. Questions? About how to protest in Excel?
No.
Okay, good. So notice, by the way, that us there in the case is about 0.5. how did you interpret that statistic? The statistics suggest that the bubble is a forecasting only about 50% of the actual growth rate annually in the United States. This is really very small for a term series model that depends on the lag. Usually there is a lot more inertia in the lag than that. But to some extent, this may be because of external changes in the data set. We had the Great Depression and then World War II, beginning about 1942. In the United States, although they were spending on arms to Europe, bringing back to about 1939, 1940. So things may be happening in this data set that are not represented by the lag. For example, if you're looking at 1940, most of the data used to forecast in 1940 is based on the Great Depression. But circumstances changed radically in 1940. Now we had the war that is affecting the spending. So the assistant is not doing a good job of explaining economic growth in the 40s because they had an external shock. So there is extra credit. Good. So before we end tonight, let's just discuss at least the basic idea behind cointegration, and then I have recorded a lecture on the Moodle page for you to look at if you want more details about cointegration. We saw before that the first difference of why is known to be stationary because the other term is the random variable is stationary. But we can think about this finding in another way. It suggests that although yt and yt minus 1 are both non-stationary, they have a relationship that is stationary. In that case, people say that yt and yt minus 1 are cointegrations. So cointegration is pretty simple. It is just a stationary relationship. In economics, we can think of cointegration as a theory about the equilibrium in the long run. For example, here is a change in consumption budget. Consumption depends on income. As it turns out, for most countries, consumption is non-stationary. Income is also non-stationary, but they are co-integrated in the sense that consumption minus the nominal value of consumption is stationary. So here, I have subtracted from consumption of left-hand variables, except the error term. But the important thing to note is that A plus B times Y is our prediction of the consumption to be. In other words, this part of the left-hand series is our economic model of consumption, a theory about the long-run value for consumption. So I will call that model value of consumption C hat. It just means that C hat is the value that we think that consumption will have. In that case, now the deviation is measuring a shock, a short-run shock away from the long-run equilibrium. So this is giving us good information. If, for example, we want to forecast the exchange rate, then the left-hand side in this case is representing a deviation from the long-run exchange rate that we have posited in our theory. And then we are able to consider the impact of shocks on the exchange rate that the vessel best decision, the full pertaining, remember this, in August 2015. But we will look more carefully about how exactly the short run change due to Southwest Fed the next time. So I will stop there. If you're interested in pursuing the use of proliferation, I have put on the middle page, if I can find it. Oh, here it is, good. Then I have given a lecture about the analysis of proliferation concerning linear velocity into that. So just to take a look at that any time that you have leisure and motivation to actually apply proliferation. Questions? Answers? Are you comfortable with the intuition behind stationarity and proliferation? It's just a really extra exercise
yes,
to help you.